back everyone to the last day of this introductory workshop. We're very happy to have Lenka Stabrova again presenting the last lecture of her course on physical physics and computation in high dimensions.
Thank you, Nike. So indeed, the fourth of the series on statistical physics and computation in high dimension. So presumably, most of you were here yesterday, so you know that we finished yesterday just with the promise of starting to add hidden variables and hidden layers into the generalized linear model. So that's what we will be doing today. And again, going back to the works in physics in the 90s, it has been done back then, notably in this paper by Schwarze, 92, where he presented the replica solution to a model that is called in the physics literature the committee machine. That is a simple neural network with hidden variables. They can be organized in few layers if you want, but the solution is in a limit. So as before, the number of samples n goes to infinity and the dimension goes to infinity with a ratio that is fixed. And the number of hidden units that the network has, which I will be denoting m, is of order one. And notably, I will be using more than this m. I will be using the number of hidden units in the first hidden layer that I will be denoting k. So that is the limit in which we know how to pull off the replica solution. Again, in the teacher-student setting where a teacher takes IID Gaussian inputs x and feeds them through the neural network with some ground truth values of weights w star and v star and obtains labels y. And then the student is presented n samples of the pairs x and y and the architecture of the network, but not the values of the weights. And the student is supposed to learn the same function or something close to the same function and be able to generalize to new samples not seen in the training set. So when you think about it, and you know, all the lecture yesterday, we were talking about this graphical model, the way you can set this model again as this precise graphical model, just with one kind of complication, that is that this time the variables W, I have P of them, so each of them will be a k-dimensional vector, where I remind that k was the number of hidden units in the first layer. So these variables w are not scalar anymore. Now they are k-dimensional vectors. And k is some small constant, think of 3 or 5. And so the w becomes a matrix that is of, you know, large dimension times small dimension. And each element will be this k-dimensional vector. And then the probability distribution that corresponds to the posterior probability distribution of the teacher-student model that you want to sample if you are to compute the Bayes optimal generalization error as we were defining it yesterday is written here. So it's again the same one. The only thing that changes is that now this W is a k-dimensional vector. So the prior that acts on it can actually correlate the different components. The important thing is that it stays separable with respect to the different dimensions, to the different components of the dimensions. And then the whole kind of hidden layer structure is taken into account in this channel, in this probability distribution that depends on the label Y. It also depends on the k scalar products between the input data and the vector of weights corresponding to one of the hidden units in the first layer. And then it also it depends on the weights of the second, third, etc. layer. But remember, we only considered number of hidden units that is of order one. So the dimension of this vector is of order one. So in the limit that we will be taking that is stating here, these are just few numbers. So we will just, if we want to be learning them, we would just treat them one by one. But we will actually, you know, the committee machine, as they solved it in the 90s, was actually using these, was actually using only one hidden layer, and the weights of the second layer were fixed to one. So that's the example that I'm giving here. That will be one of the examples that I'm using. So in that case, the pout function would just be identity, so either one or zero, whether this equality is satisfied or not, whether the label is or not, for instance, the addition of two signs on the two hidden units. So similarly to the story from yesterday, there were the papers in the 90s at which for a long time people didn't kind of go back to them until somewhat recently. So for instance, in this, sorry, there was a wrong click. In this paper 2 years ago, we took the committee machine and kind of generalized what I was telling you yesterday for the generalized linear model to this case and computed the computational to statistical gaps in learning of this two-layer neural network. So the technical contribution of that paper is that we wrote approximate message passing them and proved that the replica formula is correct. And the theorem of the replica formula is stated here. And for those who kind of have in mind, if that's the case, the formula from yesterday, this one is exactly the same, except that the order parameters now that yesterday were just colors, now they are K by K matrices, where K again is the number of hidden units in the first layer. So the formula is written in terms of expectations of these order over these order parameters. So here the expectations are just K over K by K matrices, but K is small. So these are in principle low dimensional integrals that, you know, are not as simple to evaluate as in the previous case, but still can be evaluated. So it's essentially exactly the same thing as in the generalized linear model, except that your order parameters become K by K matrices. So the proofs go in a very similar way, except, you know, now something that used to be scalar now becomes a small matrix. So some of the concentration inequalities are kind of more difficult to pull off, but it still goes through. So, okay, something happened. Sorry. So if you actually now apply this formula and try to learn what's going on in this committee machine, what's different, can you actually learn something from this solution? So one thing that is interesting that you can coin by studying this solution is what's called the specialization transition. So this is something that you can already see in the simplest possible non-trivial case where you simply have two hidden units and just one hidden layer. So K is equal to two and M also is equal to two. Here I'm taking the teacher that is using this function where I abuse a bit the notation sine of zero, I counted zero, but this is just an example. The details of that doesn't matter. And in this case, what I'm seeing here is a plot of the, so in black is the generalization error and in orange and blue are the order parameters as a function of alpha. So alpha again is the number of samples divided by the dimension. And I'm seeing here that I have two order parameters, Q00 and Q01. One of them is in a sense the overlap of one of the hidden vectors with each other in the posterior measure. And the other one is the overlap of one of the hidden vectors with the other one. So when alpha is very small, these two overlaps are the same. That means that the two hidden units behave exactly the same. And if I only had one, that's, you know, the solution would be exactly the same. So if the alpha is smaller than 2 point something in this case, I have no, so that means that I have fewer samples than something like twice the dimension, then I have absolutely no advantage of actually using the two hidden units or more of them. If I just did linear regression, I would be already reaching the base optimal performance. So that's what's happening on the left of this phase transition. And on the right of this phase transition, I start to see that the overlap that corresponds to one of the vector gets higher than the overlap, the cross overlap, which means that the two hidden units actually specialized to the vectors, to the two vectors used by the teacher. And that starting from this point, that using hidden units will actually lead to a better generalization error than we would get if you were just using linear regression. So that's the specialization phase transition. So there is a sharp threshold for the number of samples below which the linear regression is the best thing to do. And that is something that, you know, practitioners in some applications know, that if you don't have enough samples, there is little point to use deep learning. Just some support vector machine is doing the best job of what you can do. So this is a model where you can put some, you know, mathematics on that observation. So since the replica formula here comes in the form of this integral over k by k matrices, solving it actually for k bigger than 2 gets a bit cumbersome, but it simplifies when k is large. So this is this next case that I'm showing. So when k is large, but after the number of samples and the dimension was sent to infinity, then, you know, we can get some insight from the replica formula again. And here I'm using teacher of this form, and I'm plotting the generalization error again as a function of how many samples I have divided by the dimension. And what I'm seeing here is that the optimal error would be following the black full line here. But algorithmically, because we can again write the approximate message passing algorithm here and analyze what it does, and so there is a specialization phase transition when the number of samples is something like 7.6 times the number of hidden units times the dimension information theoretically. But algorithmically, we actually don't see it. Algorithmically, we only see it if the sample complexity scales with the square of the number of hidden units. So as we are adding hidden units, there is actually a big algorithmic gap in this problem with a teacher that matches the student. So the teacher is also very wide. So this may be that, you know, as you are getting the teacher wide, that actually becomes quite a complicated function. So we don't know whether, you know, width kind of makes large hard phases appear, but in this precise case it does, but we don't know whether it is true more generically. That's an interesting question. So far we were dealing with order one hidden units, but, you know, that doesn't seem like getting us very far towards kind of more state-of-the-art deep learning, where we have many layers and they are wide and sometimes very wide. So can we deal with more hidden units? So a problem that, you know, a setting kind of in the setting that looks like we should be able to solve it with the replica method would be the following. So I restrict here to a single hidden layer, but now I don't make it small, I make it large. I make it extensive, its size will be k, and k will also be going to infinity with, again, a ratio between k and p that is some constant. And if I do it this way, then the teacher uses actually order n times order n matrix. The first layer would be order n times order n. So if I only had scalar labels, then I wouldn't have enough information to actually learn back that order n times order n matrix. So the way I set it here, I also make the output extensive. So that's some kind of sequence to sequence learning. So why not? This is just like a mathematical model. So I also make the output extensive, and its size will be m. And again, the ratio between m and p will be of order one. And in this case, the teacher-student setting is kind of well posed information theoretically. That's kind of the regime where things should get from trivially unsolvable to trivially solvable when I am twiddling with these constants. The thing is that we are trying to solve this case for already maybe 5-6 years, and so far we didn't manage. So if I asked the question as before, was the optimal generalization error of the student network? I don't know. And we don't even have a closed form formula of the, you know, heuristic replica kind that, you know, even without the proof. So we do have many formulas, but all of them are actually not exact, all of those that we like wrote so far. So we always found some country example where it's just not giving us the right thing. So we don't have one about which I would be confident to say this is the conjecture for the exact learning curve for this model. So this is an open problem. I will come back to it in a bit, like to kind of explain that if we could solve this one, we could then easily generalize to multiple layers. So just to wrap up, so 3 points here. If we try to go deep, if we try to go multi-layer with these kind of techniques and this kind of computations, so we are kind of blocked at the case where we try to treat one single hidden layer if it is extensive. If it is small, of course, that was the case of the committee machine. So this is solved. And then in the small font, I'm just listing like few kind of recent progresses about which you probably heard, kind of explaining how they fit or not in this regime. So, you know, solvable case are linear networks, but those are not expressive enough. So we want to keep the nonlinearities there. And then you have probably heard about the neural tangent kernel, but that becomes kernel learning. There is no feature learning. So we would like to actually describe feature learning. Even the simple committee machine with just few hidden units is able to learn things that just kernel methods in high dimensions are not able to learn. So then there is the case when the single hidden layer gets much larger than the dimension, and that's the mean field limit, in which case you can describe the behavior of the gradient descent via an exact equation. But as far as I know, there is no kind of reduction of that equation to something even simpler when the dimension is going to infinity and it's really large. So none of those are really getting us what we would like to like get if I could solve the problem on the previous slide. But there are two other points that, you know, I will spend the rest of this last lecture on, that where we can actually do something interestingly connected to deep learning. So the first of them that, you know, I mentioned already in the list of problems at the very beginning is the deep generative priors for the vector W. So let me explain what this is about. So this is actually quite a popular topic these days in the imaging communities. So, you know, imagine the community that, say, 10 years ago would be studying compressed sensing and being very interested in the fact that signals can be represented in a basis in which they are sparse, leading to compressed sensing. And pretty much a large part of this community is these days excited about the following thing, that, you know, taking inspiration from deep generative models that generate pictures of people, for instance, like here down in the slide, that look very, very realistic, are able to capture like amazing structure. That given, you know, if you have enough data, you can train such a model, meaning that your signal S star can be represented in this following form that just corresponds to a generator of a GAN or to the decoder of an autoencoder, that, you know, depends which method you use to train on your data. But the common point that they have is that while this S star might be high dimensional, the way you represent it, for instance, in the GAN is that the generator would have an input that has dimension k that is usually much smaller than the dimensionality of this vector S star. And then the way you use the GAN is you simply feed here random Gaussian noise. And because you learn these weight matrices smartly, it produces images that look realistic, that look very much like your training set. But what this is then doing is that it's basically compression of the signal. You compressed your new, you know, you compressed your signals into something that has much smaller dimension. So it's playing a bit similar role to the sparsity. You represent your signal via something that has much smaller dimension. So the natural question then comes, you know, can you do compressed sensing not thanks to sparsity, but thanks to the fact that you're able to represent your signals to be in a range of this low dimensional generative model. So that's the idea. And so here I'm just plugging into this equation, and then here I, you know, because in the compress sensing we usually call things differently, but I will call this nonlinearity, and this matrix I will also call it phi and w. So I actually end up with the problem like that, where, you know, concretely the case that we can solve and analyze is the one where, again, there is a teacher that generates the X star from some prior distribution PX. And then the matrices W, they are known. And for the analysis, we also need them to be random IID. So far, we don't know how to treat matrices that are learned in some realistic generative adversarial network, for instance. But we can go on with the analysis if these matrices were IID. So that's capturing hopefully some of the structure. And then the teacher generates the labels, or Y's, the vector Y. And then the goal here is, from the knowledge of the Y and W, can we estimate back the vector X? So it's a bit like in the generalized linear model, except that you have like multiplication by a matrix nonlinearity several times here. So is that something that we can solve? And the answer is yes. And to kind of realize how that comes, that we can solve that case, I come back here to the generalized approximate message passing algorithm and kind of write it to you a little differently in kind of intuitively what it is actually doing. The approximate message passing algorithm is taking the posterior measure of the generalized linear model. So here I'm back at the single layer case. I'm just going to explain how from the single layer case we are going to obtain the multi-layer solution. So what the approximate message passing algorithm is doing is basically assuming, and it ends up that this assumption is asymptotically correct, that the variable that would correspond to this scalar product is actually, you know, what it should be kind of based on the output channel times a Gaussian of a certain mean and a variance. And that mean and variance, that's exactly the variables that are being updated in the AMP algorithm. And similarly for the variables X, it assumed that it comes from whatever the prior is times a Gaussian of a mean and variance that are again parameters that are being updated in the algorithm. And so it's, you know, and thanks to that, and the updates are just summarized here. That's what I was showing yesterday, but one kind of needs to be familiar with the algorithms to decipher that. But that property, that it's basically an kind of effective, that it's basically looking at the problem as an effective prior, as a set of scalar denoising problems with just effective prior that is being updated. This is something super useful. Once you realize that, then you can go back to this multi-layer problem and kind of separate it into the different layers by introducing auxiliary variables H that will be basically the post-activations of each of the layers. So this is how they are defined. So these probability distributions P out and the nonlinearities phi are just related to each other, that, you know, P out is just the identity of phi giving the right output. And so once you do that, you actually can kind of unroll the multi-layer graphical model into something like this, where these auxiliary variables H, you put them explicitly in. And then you realize if you look at one piece, that's a generalized linear regression. And this piece is also a generalized linear regression. And the way they are connected is only through those parameters that you're updating in the approximate message passing algorithm. So if you put all that together, you actually realize that you can take the approximate message passing of one of the model and glue it together with the other one. And, you know, as a kind of a Lego principle, you just put the pieces together. So if you had a solvable graphical model, then you can write the free energy of the chain of these graphical models by combining them. And more specifically, the way you do it is that In the generalized approximate message passing for this multi-layer case, you basically treat it piece by piece by just realizing that what is before or after is just slightly changing either the distribution that would be the prior if you only had that piece, or the distribution that would be the output channel if you only had that piece. So concretely for the prior on the hidden layer L, it will also depend on the output variables of the preceding layer by simply multiplying whatever is the activation on the hidden layer L by a Gaussian that has the proper mean and variance that you got from the approximate message passing from the previous layer. And similarly for the output distribution, that will depend on the next layer, not on the previous one. So these L here are the indices of the layers. And so when you put all this together, you write something that looks very much like the ordinary approximate message passing algorithm, except that it has here the L indices. So you just iterate it layer by layer and you do again and again. So the number of layers here is considered fixed. Imagine something like 10 or 20. And it has kind of the same complexity. And so once you realize that, and that's, you know, in these papers that I'm citing, that's what we did, you actually can generalize all the results that I have been telling you about for the single layer. So you can compute the asymptotically exact mutual informations or free energies. You can compute the minimum mean square of the base optimal inference of the X star from the Y and W's. You can write the state evolution of this multi-layer AMP. And you can look whether this multi-layer AMP is giving you the information theoretic optimal performance or not. And we also, we can also pull off the adaptive interpolation to prove that those mutual informations and free energies are correct. But there, for some technical problems, so far we only managed to do it for two layers. There are some concentration results that we still don't know how to do in this precise case for three layers. But this seems to be like a technical problem. That's something that should be solvable if somebody smarter thinks about it a bit more. There is nothing conceptual in my opinion there. So once you do that, you can start looking at some results, like what is something interesting that you can learn about this multi-layer generalized linear model. So here I'm showing you back a phase diagram that I showed you already yesterday for the phase retrieval. So this would be just the single layer case with sparse prior. And I want to compare the sparse prior to this generative model prior. So here, this would be the number of measurements over the dimensions. So in the phase retrieval language, it would be measurements, but in the linear regression language is the number of samples. So this is the alpha here on the y-axis, alpha. And on the x-axis is the sparsity. So what fraction of your components of the signal are non-zero? And you have the impossible and hard phase that actually I was mentioning yesterday, that in the case of phase retrieval, you do not sense compressively because this algorithmic phase transition saturates at 1/2 instead of going to zero and allowing you fewer measurements as you have more and more sparsity. And in the case of the generative prior, so here is again the alpha, so number of samples over dimension, but on the x-axis, I try to match kind of the dimensionality reduction. So before it's number of non-zero components over the dimension, and here is the number of elements in the latent space in the size of the x over the dimension. So that's kind of morally playing the same role. And here concretely, I use a very simple, just a single layer generative model for the signal, that I say that the signal is a output of a ReLU of a random IID matrix W times X, and X is Gaussian here. The teacher just uses a Gaussian. And I have a phase diagram that again shows impossible, hard, and easy phase. But this is just one example. And in all examples that we evaluated, we always kind of systematically saw that the hard phase shrinks, gets smaller, or completely disappears in some cases, if we, instead of the sparsity, use the generative priors. So again, this is, you know, different model, because here we are matching the teacher to the estimation that we are doing. It's not like a different method on the same data set. So this doesn't really mean that with generative priors, things will be easier in practice, not directly, but it kind of suggests so, and is definitely intriguing to investigate whether this is true in practice, whether if you do, say, computed tomography or NMR, whether representing your signals via sparsity is actually, whether representing your signals via generative models is actually advantageous with respect to compress sensing than representing them via sparsity. So that's kind of an open question in the field, but this kind of suggests that it might be so. And yeah, so here I'm just summarizing that with generative priors, compressive phase retrieval is possible. Yeah, that's actually the fact that the curve, the green curve, goes to zero, that it doesn't saturate at any finite alpha, means that if I use a generative prior, then I can kind of take advantage of the compression also algorithmically. So I don't have the same trouble as if I use sparsity. So that's you know, interesting. And the hard phase shrinks or disappears when using generative priors. And this is something that we have seen in our work, but also for the phase retrieval, it appeared in this work 2 years ago in NeurIPS. So just one last comment back to this Lego principle. So I was saying that if I have pieces of solvable graphical models, then I can glue them together and use the same methods to solve the multi-layer case. And so all the cases in which kind of this can be done, we have, you know, those of you who like to play with codes, I invite you to see this Trump implementation that we have for module. It's a modular implementation of this approximate message passing for tree-like probabilistic graphical models. But basically all the models and problems that we have worked on in the last, say, 10 years, I included there. And this is a paper that goes with it. It's on GitHub. You can play with it. You can like easily pull phase diagrams just by like running very kind of modular, not having to do basically anything. And so it's very generic. And this kind of brings me back to this open problem that, you know, here I need the module to be solvable. So if I could solve this single hidden layer module, that Lego principle kind of makes me confident that then I could solve any number of layers. So this is why this, you know, not being able to write a proper replica formula for this model is kind of really blocking us on the way of trying to say something relevant about the deep, about learning in deep networks. So if somebody has some ideas, I would be happy to discuss. But this brings me to the third point here, which is another way to kind of merge deep generative models with these works done with the replica method or in statistical physics on the generalized linear model. And it was the difference. So in the second point, I was generating the signal W with a gun, say. And now the third point is actually about generating the data itself from a generative neural network. Because so far, up to now, I was always assuming that the input data is a random IID Gaussian matrix, which it clearly is never in practice. So that's like a very, very strong weak point of all this analysis, and basically its relevance to kind of broad relevance to practical cases. So we definitely need to understand what happens if the data have structure. They are not just IID Gaussian vectors. So that's exactly the point that we investigate in these works and that I want to tell you about now. So I go back to the generative adversarial networks that are able to capture the structure that is able to, from noise, generate faces like those that are basically, you know, I would never have, like, these to me looked like totally credible existing people that you could have dinner with or something. So they are able to do that. So our inspiration is basically, can we kind of mimic? So it means that the structure, that the generator has is rich enough to capture what we need to capture real data. And what that means, as I was saying before, the input into the generator is usually much lower dimensional than the dimension of the input space. So that means that if you look in the input space, the set of images or data that we are interested in, it lies on some low dimension manifold, on some submanifold of that input space that is actually defined by that by the generator. So if I like look at it pictorially, there is the input space, which in this case would be three-dimensional, and then there is some submanifold on which the interesting data lie, and then there is a lot of space around where it's just some random unstructured noise that is not so interesting. And when I'm learning, I basically don't even want to learn the function that I'm interested in on that part, because that's not where my data lie. And the very existence of GANs and VAEs is kind of attesting that that's what's going on. And so we just take inspiration from that and try to build a model that looks like a generator of a GAN or a VAE, but is still solvable within the same precision and down to the constants as we are kind of used to from the simple case with IID data. And so this is what we do in this paper called the hidden manifold model, where I start with the single layer case. So the data X here will be generated as basically a single layer generator. So maybe a way to describe what this is, what this definition actually means, I go back to this image. So the matrix F here will be describing the coordinates of the subspace that so far is completely flat in the input space. And then the matrix C here will be describing the coordinates in that flat subspace of the points, of the data points. Then the teacher is generating labels that actually depends on the coordinates in that subspace, so on this C matrix. So for instance, splitting in some way, like here for classification. And then the nonlinear function F here is kind of folding that flat manifold into something that is not so easily findable just by PCA, because if it was flat, then I can very easily see it with PCA. But the nonlinearity kind of destroys that. So this F here is, I will be using sine, for instance, in some of the examples I will be showing. So this is destroying the fact that this is, if it was not there, it was just a low rank matrix. So this X is not a low rank matrix. But I keep the teacher acting on the components of the C matrix. So that's kind of the intuition where this model comes from. So as I said, one motivation for this model is that we are able to solve it, kind of describe very much in detail the learning curves and how much samples is needed to get certain error, etc. But another the main motivation is that it actually captures the structure and the properties of the learning as we have in some, toy data sets such as MNIST in this figure. In the paper, we also have CIFAR. So here, for instance, what I'm showing the performance of the committee machine, because in terms of learning, as I said, that's the most complex one that we know how to analyze so far. So we kind of stuck with that one for the analysis of the learning. But already this committee machine, which is just a single hidden layer neural network with just few hidden units. So in this case, 1, 2, 4, and 8, it's already doing something non-trivial on the MNIST. So the blue curve would be just one hidden layer. So that's one hidden unit, sorry. So effectively none. So just linear regression. So the blue curve here is the generalization error that you would get on an MNIST if you were just doing linear regression. So you get something. And if you are using already two hidden units, so just slightly a little bit more, you do a bit better. And if you're using 4, you do a bit better, and 8, you do a bit better. And you see that here you see kind of a similar thing that I was talking about the specialization phase transition. So this kind of the fact that at the beginning you do as bad as the linear regression, and then you only start doing better, that's due to the specialization of the hidden units. And so this is just an empirical run on MNIST. And you see that on the hidden manifold model where the latent dimension is 10, so kind of matching the roughly the latent dimension of MNIST, is you're seeing basically the same thing. So that's one property that it reproduces. And another one that we actually don't think can be like straightforwardly reproduced with the canonical teacher-student model, so we really need the hidden manifold model for this, is depicted here. So again, I'm comparing MNIST to what's happening on the hidden manifold model. The pictures are very comparable, but what is plotted? So again, I'm learning just with the committee machine, this time with K hidden units. So I'm changing here, it is 1, 2, 3, 4, et cetera, hidden units. And I am on the same data set and with the same kind of ordering of the samples. And the only thing I am learning twice, and the only thing I'm changing in the two runs is the initialization. So the initialization, the canonical one in neural networks, is just you just pick the weights at random with the given variance. And so I'm just drawing a different random number in the two cases. But otherwise, I'm running exactly the same algorithm, the same learning rate, the same everything. And once I do that, I look at the generalization error, and that's the blue curve, that's the blue point. And so you see that I'm doing, you know, 10% on MNIST is really not good. I mean, this is not a very good network. This is just a toy example. And as I'm adding, this is just the linear regression is getting 10%. So, you know, that's as good as it can get for linear regression. As you're adding hidden units, it's getting a bit better. Okay, not a big deal. That's not what is interesting on this image. What is interesting is the behavior of the orange and green curve. So the orange curve here is, if you actually look now whether these two students agree on the test set, that's how often they agree, or rather how often they disagree. Sorry, how often they disagree. So since it is small, you basically see they always agree. I mean, on some rare examples, they disagree, but they on the ones on which you are wrong anyway, they maybe disagree, but it's low. Now the green points, that's the disagreement of the two students if you don't test them on the test set that lies on the submanifold, but if you test them just on IID Gaussian noise that, you know, doesn't lie on the submanifold of the data. And you see that if you do that, the linear regression, you learn kind of the same thing with the two students. And if you have two hidden units, you still kind of learn really the same function, even completely out of the space in which the data set lives. But already if you have 3 and more hidden units, which really is not much, the neural network is kind of realizing that it doesn't have to learn the same function on the rest of the subspace, on the input space. It can just learn on the subspace. So that's pretty amazing that already with 3 hidden units, that this simple neural network is able to figure out that on the subspace on which MNIST actually lives, it should learn the function and not out of it. So that's kind of telling you something, you know, when you think about learning the function on the whole input space, this is kind of a wrong concept because you're not learning it on the whole input space. And this is something that with the simple teacher student, we didn't manage to reproduce it, but with the hidden manifold model, you reproduce exactly this kind of behavior. So that's one property that makes us really kind of confident that this is an interesting model to describe the structure in the data that is relevant for how the learning in these simple cases behaves. So that's the motivation why it should be interesting. And now the second part, that we can solve it. So indeed, we can solve it. And kind of here are works that led to that solution. So there is a very related work by Andrea Montanari and his students and collaborators in a special case where the matrix F is random. Yeah, I didn't say that, but in our case, we will be able to do it for generic F. The F doesn't need to be random. It can be completely deterministic. And they looked at least square regression and max margin loss. And in that case, actually, you know, not thinking about the hidden manifold model, but in two slides it will become clear why what they did is precisely what we need to be doing. So the techniques are very related. And then we solved this case of the committee machine and generic matrix F in the online, so stochastic gradient descent, where you only do one pass in this paper. And then we solved it with the replica method in the batch kind of gradient descent case in this paper. But this is the kind of a good old non-rigorous replica result. So here is my open problem 4, whether the solution that is presented in this paper can be proved rigorously, at least for convex losses, which is the ones we also focused on, because then the approximate message passing and the gradient descent must be going to the same fixed point. So at least for those. And how does the solution go? So a key element behind being able to solve for the generalization error in this hidden manifold model is what we call a Gaussian equivalence property or theorem. That is telling us, so if I remind, you know, what we are doing. So the X is generated as a nonlinearity on a product of two matrices. All these matrices have sizes that are extensive with ratios between them that are fixed. These are just two parameters then later appearing in the equations. And the teacher acts with some nonlinearity on this C matrix. So the Gaussian equivalence states that the learning curve of the committee machine for this model is exactly the same as it would be if you actually replaced this X, where the nonlinearity is making your life harder because it's kind of scrambling the linear subspace. If you replaced it by something that is just linear plus noise plus identity. So with these coefficients basically depending on what this nonlinearity exactly is. So these are some like Hermite coefficients related to this function. And so this was rather surprising to us that this nonlinearity actually doesn't matter in a sense so much, or it appears in some very innocent way in these coefficients. So once we have that, then basically solving this model becomes equivalent to solving just the ordinary model with generic covariance. And that's something that can be done. So if you do that, you end up with the replica solution, which this in this case is a little bulky, but it has the same form as before. All the other parameters are scalar. You just have, you know, number of equations here. The loss that you're minimizing appears just here via a special function eta. The matrix F that I was saying can be arbitrary. It appears only through the Stieltjes transform of FF transpose. So as long as this is well behaving and converging something in the limit we are considering, we can treat any matrix F. So that's very generic class of matrices. And the nonlinearity appears through these coefficients kappa here. And we don't have a proof for this set of equations, but if we actually plug them into computer and see what they mean, we can get the learning curves and phase diagrams. So for instance, this one, where the data are generated as an error function on the product of these two matrices, and the Y is just sine on a product of the teacher vector and the C matrix. So this is a classification task. The Ys will be binary, and we are looking here at least square regression on this Y and on that X. And this is the generalization error that we get as a function of the number of samples divided by dimension. And depending on the regularization that we put to this least square regression, you know, we can see that, you know, optimal regularization has some behavior, and then we should not regularize too much, not too little. If you regularize too little, we have this interpolation peak, this peak that appears at the number of samples at which the training error goes to zero. And we can plot things like this, where here is the number of sample over the dimension, and here is the latent dimension over the dimension. And the color code is for the size of the error. And you kind of see in this picture that what matters more is the slope here rather than the number of samples, which is telling us that even rather simple linear regression on this kind of classification problem is picking that there is some intrinsic dimension D rather than that it should, you know, behave or depend on the dimensionality of the input space. So that's kind of interesting. But now, you know, to random features, because at the beginning of the lecture I was promising that I will be talking of random features. So when you actually think about learning with random features, you realize that it's just a renaming of the variables in the hidden manifold model. That is just the same thing. So if you want to think about random features, you need to say that this time the matrix C is the data. And now the teacher is acting on the data as it was, you know, for 30 years in the statistical physics literature and more recently in kind of more broader literature where people look at the teacher-student setting. Then the matrix F corresponds to the features you project to a higher dimensional space. So D here would be the dimension of the input space. P would be the dimensionality of the space into which you project. And then you apply some nonlinearity. And that creates your projections X. So X here would be the projections. And if you call things this way, then, and you know, use the same solution because mathematically nothing changed. The limit we consider is still the same. But now you can interpret things and talk of overparametrization because then the dimension P is the size of the hidden layer. And the larger it is, the more overparameterized your neural network is. So then it is more interesting to plot the generalization and train error and the training loss as a function of this overparametrization over the number of samples. And so that's what I'm doing here. And I'm plotting on the same data set the result of the logistic of minimization of the logistic loss, the square loss. The full curves would be at some fairly small regularization, and the dashed curves would be at the value of the regularization that gives the smallest generalization error. So you see, for instance, here you are seeing the two interpolation peaks, but for the two losses, they don't happen at the same place. For the square loss, the interpolation peak is at one, because that's where the matrix is invertible. But for the logistic loss, the interpolation peak appears where the data stop to be being linearly separable, which of course depends on how you constructed the data, which in this particular case is here. And that's also why the training loss goes to zero, because when it is zero, the data are linearly separable. And you can also compute actually where this linear separability transition happens. And if you remember from yesterday, the linear separability is the storage capacity, the Gardner storage capacity. So this again is connecting to the other things that we were talking yesterday. And you can compute where the phase transition is as a function of here is the dimension in which you are projecting over number of samples, and here's the number of samples over the dimension of the space. And so if the dimension D is very large, you're at zero here, then you're back at the cover threshold, one over the cover threshold. So instead of two, here we have half. And as you're changing the dimensionality D, this separability transition is shifting. And depending which random features you're using, so red would be just Gaussian IAD random features and blue are orthogonal features, the separability transition also depends on that. And so that's, you know, I just want to point here also a somewhat recent work from the Gandes group where they analyze a similar phenomena, the fact that the, you know, in some problems the logistic regression is just the maximum likelihood estimator for the given problem. So being separable or not translates to the maximum likelihood estimator actually existing or not existing. So that's the same type of a phase transition in a little bit a different model. So we can get that very explicitly from the replica formula. But here I'm also showing you, you know, the point of this slide is that, you know, these are all results when DNP is infinity and ratios are fixed. But even if the sizes are really, really small, like here 200, you actually see very good agreement between the just numerical performance if you actually run in scikit-learn the minimization of those losses and the asymptotic curves. So here is for the L2 loss, here is for the logistic loss, here is small regularization, here is optimal regularization. And I have blue and red lines. The blue one are random features that are just Gaussian IID matrix. And the red ones are random features that is subsampled Fourier matrix, so orthogonal ones. So something you can do. And you see that systematically the red one is getting better generalization error than the blue one. And this is, you know, again, something that in kind of more empirical work has been seen and predicted. For instance, in this paper at NeurIPS, the unreasonable effectiveness of structured random orthogonal embeddings, that for learning, it is better actually to use random features that are not IID Gaussian features. And this is also what we are confirming when we actually apply the theory to these cases. And this is slowly getting me towards the end. So the last point I want to make is, you know, so far the hidden manifold model, I was just using nonlinearity on a product of two matrices. So this is effectively just one layer generative model. Now, can we generalize that whole analysis and the theory to deep generative models? So that's something kind of still in progress. We so far have one paper on that, but it's very, very encouraging in the sense that what's most important. So the data model here is the same as before, but simply instead of using one layer, now I'm using multiple layers. And the result is that yes, we can write. So in this paper, what we actually wrote is the solution of this online stochastic gradient descent, but we also can write the solution of the replica method for the batch estimation, which is not yet in that paper. But what's really interesting that we kind of saw empirically in this paper is that this does not only work if the generative model has random IID weights, but it also works if the generative model has the actual weights that were learned in some actual generative model. And this is something I just want to show you last two slides. So for instance, here we took deep convolutional GAN that we just took from the, you know, state of the art, and we used it with random weights, but still the fact that it is convolutional, it gives a lot of structure to these matrices that are not at all IID random as they were before. And we just took on the CIFAR, you know, what the authors provide as the generators learned and used them to generate data. And then on that data, generated the labels using the teacher and compared whether indeed the theory is capturing the evolution of the learning. And here in the plots is for, so these plots are for random weights and these are for the actually trained weights. And the lines are the results of the theory and the points are just results of the simulation. And you see here, we are predicting how the dynamics, what the dynamics is doing at the given number of steps or epochs for different quantities like the error, the generalization error, different order parameters. On the pre-trained weights, we are sometimes a little bit off, but that is a finite size effect because the dimensionality of this generator of the input space is quite small, it's just 100. And so to confirm that this was a finite size effect, we actually used a different type of generative models, which are normalizing flows, which have the advantage that they are invertible, but we are not using the invertibility here. But since they're invertible, the input space is as big as the latent space. So in this case, much larger. So when something is 3000, then usually the asymptotic results of the replica method already like kick in basically all, you know, majority of the cases that I've ever studied. And so indeed, in this case, even for the pre-trained weights or the real trained weights, we see a great agreement between the theory and what is actually going on in the simulation. So this is probably, at least, you know, in my kind of level of what I am happy about, is like first time when you can write a closed formula for what the gradient descent is doing at some finite time on realistically looking input data, not only IIT data. And here, you know, this is how realistically they are looking for this particular generative model. This is a real sci-far images, and these are images that this generative model is generating. So you don't recognize like animals and stuff, but definitely there is a lot of structure, and they kind of look at some kind of natural looking images. So, but there is more to follow up on that. So with that, I want to, you know, conclude this lecture and thank you for the attention, especially those of you who stayed till the end of the 4 lectures and the whole 10 days of the bootcamp. And that's a question time if you have questions.
Okay, thank you so much, Lenka. I also want to say thanks a lot to Sebastian Gold and Bruno Lurero, they have been answering questions throughout the 4 lectures. So thanks a lot.
Are there any... I joined that. I forgot to mention them, but indeed, people who were asking questions were realizing that they are postdocs in our group and responsible for especially the works that I talked about today, I think all of them.
Yeah, so thank you. Thank you so much for that. Are there any questions? Feel free to raise your hand or type it into the Q&A. So maybe I can start with a question going back to the early part of this lecture. So the committee machine with a constant number of hidden units. So you mentioned that when the number k gets large, you can also analyze that case. But do you emphasize that the k has to go to infinity after you let n and p go to infinity? So if you let them go at the same time, is it that it's difficult to analyze, or that the behavior is truly different?
If they go at the same time, that's the open problem that becomes equivalent to the open problem that I was stating. Yeah, we don't know how to do that. And we also don't know how that limit behaves in the same. We don't know whether if you take P and N to infinity and then K to infinity, whether it is in any way similar to actually switching the limits. This is still not clear.
I see. And the second model you presented on this, the two-layer perceptron, this is a degenerate limit of that, of the committee model, or no?
Yeah, so we don't know whether if you actually could solve the model where the K, P, and N go to infinity together, whether you would be getting back the results of the committee machine. I don't know. That's a good question, but I don't know.
Are there other questions? Okay, then thanks, Lenka, so much for these beautiful talks. And we have a coffee break, and then we meet back here in 25 minutes for Encore's talk.